Hey, what's up, guys? So light therapy has been getting a ton of attention lately, and even though sunlight therapy has been around for centuries to treat things like mood disorders and vitamin D deficiencies, there has been an explosion of popularity surrounding light therapy, especially when it comes to red light therapy. However, it has gained even more attention over the past few months because of scientists like Andrew Huberman and talk show hosts such as Tucker Carlson that have been talking about it in detail.
And the Juve that we were using in the documentary, there's a massive amount
Which is testicle tanning.
However, there appears to be several possible applications of light therapy. However, the main one that I am most interested in is its possible application to improving testosterone levels. So essentially what I want to do in this video is talk about the three primary categories of light therapy and walk through some of the research that has been performed on those categories of light therapy, and then talk about their possible applications to improving testosterone levels. So let's dive right in. Now, before we dive into the specific research on these categories of light, I do think it is important for us to define what these types of light forms are. And essentially what we have is light forms that are divided and specified in accordance with their wavelength. Now, at the short end of the spectrum, you have UV light, which many of us are familiar with. And this specific form of light is categorized by its wavelength of 200 to 400 nanometers. Now, within this category, you have three primary categories of UV light, which are UVA, B, and C. Now, C mostly gets filtered out by the Earth's atmosphere, so we're not going to spend a ton of time talking about that today. However, when it comes to UVB light, this is light that is within the spectrum of 200 to 320 nanometers, and this is the light that causes the production of vitamin D when it comes into contact with the skin. Whereas UVA, which is between 300 to 400 nanometers, is the form of light that causes the skin to tan when it comes into contact with it. And this is primarily the form of light that most tanning beds emit. Now, beyond this, you also have the visible light spectrum, which is between 400 to 700 nanometers in wavelength. And this includes things like purple, blue, green, yellow, and orange, as well as red. And now, beyond this, you also have near infrared, which is light that is just beyond the red wavelength, which is usually between 700 to 1,000 nanometers. Now, it is worth noting here that all of these forms of light can be obtained through the sun, which is presumably why the body actually responds to it so biologically. You know, humans have adapted to life on Earth, and obviously the sun is a major part of that, and so it's no surprise that the human body actually does respond to these forms of light with a biological response. Now, when it comes to the research on these various forms of light, it's going to help us to kind of rewind all the way back to some of the first studies that were ever published on light therapy, and those date all the way back to 1939, where Dr. Meyerson, in this study with his team, set out to assess the effects of UV light on testosterone levels. Now, in this study, Dr. Meyerson and his team did find that exposing the participants of this study to that combination of UV and infrared light over the course of about 5 days led to roughly an 120% increase in testosterone levels, which is pretty astounding. Now, for those of you that aren't statisticians, this is roughly a doubling in testosterone levels, which is pretty astounding. And what's more is that Dr. Meyerson and his team found that when they specifically exposed the participants of this study, exposed their nether regions to this same lamp, that there was actually a 200% increase in testosterone levels, which again is roughly a 3x in testosterone levels. However, I do think it's important to note here that even though Dr. Meyerson and his team did attribute a lot of the effects of this study to specifically UV light, when you look at the experimental design, you will notice that his team team did use a combination lamp of UV light and infrared light. And it's also important to note here that they did not differentiate between the use of UVA and UVB. Now, this isn't necessarily a limitation in the study. However, it is important to keep in mind because we really just don't know if the results of this study are because of the UV light or the infrared light. Now, Dr. Meyerson and his team did give some possible mechanisms of action in the discussion portion of the paper that was written on this study. However, it isn't exactly clear as to why this was actually happening in this specific study. However, one of the obvious possible mechanisms of action here is the connection between UVB light and vitamin D levels. There is an extremely strong connection between UVB exposure and vitamin D levels, as well as an extremely strong correlation between vitamin D levels and testosterone. And not only is there an extremely strong correlation between UVB and vitamin D levels, but there's also an extremely strong connection between UVB and testosterone levels independent of vitamin D. And so this definitely appears to be one of the possible mechanisms of action that is going on here. However, it doesn't appear to be the only mechanism of action. Now, there have also been a handful of studies that have been published on the connection between UV light and infrared light and its connection to fertility. And in this study that summarized all the findings from all of those studies, the researchers concluded that analysis of the scientific literature suggests that laser therapy should be used as much as possible in the complex treatment of men with infertility, since the effectiveness of the method is not just high, but often has no alternatives. For laser illumination, it is best to use exclusively pulsed red light and infrared light for local illumination, alternating with a continuous wavelength of 635 nanometers and 365 nanometers. And so what's interesting about this review paper is that they concluded that not only does UVB light have an effect on fertility and testicular function, but also UVA, red light, and infrared light. And the reason this is so interesting is that none of these wavelengths have anything to do with vitamin D production, so it definitely appears like something else is going on here. Now, when it comes to red light specifically, I think this is one of the more interesting wavelengths simply because the red light spectrum doesn't even penetrate the tissue like UV and infrared does, which suggests that there may actually be photoreceptors on the nether regions that are sensitive to this specific spectrum of light that cause a cascade of events that ultimately improves testosterone production and infertility. This specific study here actually found some pretty significant effects on testosterone levels when the nether regions of the rodents were actually exposed directly to red light. Now, the exact mechanism of action here I don't think is extremely clear. However, some researchers are proposing that there may be some link between red light exposure and ATP production in the cells that are directly exposed to that red light. However, I don't think this is extremely settled in science yet. Now, the last form of light that we're going to talk about that appears to have some type of direct effect on testosterone levels is just simply bright light. In this study in particular, the researchers actually saw a 71% increase in testosterone levels of the participants that were just simply exposed to a bright light box. And one of the reasons I think this is so interesting is that it was just simply a box that emitted really bright light. Now, it's not exactly clear as to why bright light would directly cause an increase in testosterone levels. However, the researchers in this study were hypothesizing that it could be because of the interaction with bright light and the pineal gland. So bright light does shut down the pineal gland, which is the gland in the brain that produces melatonin and kind of induces sleep. And so they were hypothesizing that by kind of inhibiting the production of melatonin and kind of signaling to your body that it's time to get up and do stuff. And because testosterone is in large a hormone that essentially tells your body to do difficult things, that there might be some interaction here with bright light and testosterone levels because of this specific mechanism. Now, all in all, it does appear that pretty much all of the light spectrums that are emitted from the sun have some varying degree of effect on fertility and testicular function, as well as testosterone levels. And so I think one of the major and first takeaways here is just to get more sunlight. Now, some experts recommend roughly between 15 to 45 minutes of direct sunlight exposure per day. And this largely depends on your skin tone and your ability to kind of respond biologically to that sunlight. However, when it comes to directly exposing the nether regions to direct sunlight, I would be a whole lot more careful here. There is some research to suggest that there may actually be some damage from overexposure of some of these light spectrums to the nether regions. And so if you're going to be doing what's been termed testicle tanning, I would be extremely, extremely safe about it. However, it does appear that direct light exposure to your underparts may actually have some positive effects on fertility, testicular function, and testosterone levels through various mechanisms. Now, when it comes to the winter months, when it is a little bit more difficult to get direct sunlight exposure, I do think using some artificial lights might be of benefit. And so the first one that you kind of want to focus on getting is a SAD light, which is like a seasonal affective disorder light, which is essentially just a big old bright light that exposes your retina to a lot of light and is supposed to kind of signify to your brain that the sun is up and help kind of shut down the pineal gland from working and producing melatonin and kind of jumpstart the production of testosterone. But beyond that, I would also look into getting a red light, and red light specifically seems to be one of the safer options when it comes to the undergarment tanning, so to speak, because of its safety profile. Now, when it comes to UV exposure and infrared exposure, because these types of light do penetrate into the tissue, I do think you have to be a lot more careful with these forms of light. However, bright light and red light seem to be extremely safe options for eye exposure as well as under region exposure. Now, again, infrared and UV exposure may be some good options according to some of the research. However, if I were you, I would do some further research to ensure that you're getting some safe lights that aren't actually going to cause any damage at the end of the day. Now, if you have yet to get a hormone panel done, I would highly recommend my friends over at Let's Get Checked. A lot of you guys know that I have been recommending them for a while now, but they literally have the most convenient service on the market. Once you order your test, they send it to your doorstep, you send it back to them, and then within a few days, you have your results through their online portal. And on top of that, you get a free consultation with a practitioner that walks you through your results. It's extremely freaking easy. And so make sure to check out the link that's in the description for 30% off of your test. But other than that, guys, if you have any questions about this specifically, feel free to leave a comment down below, and I will see you guys next time.